second coming is not the rapture. Bah, bah. Rapture's not the second coming. Bah, bah, bah. Like a stupid, dumb animal that can't think.
Steven Anderson is a false teacher who stands in defiance of Scripture on numerous points. Today we're going to look at what he teaches about the return of Jesus Christ. It's shocking for me to hear him openly contradict the Lord and to challenge the plain statements of Scripture, but he does. Those who follow him and encourage others to do so are partakers of his evil deeds. The second coming of Christ is a doctrine with many facets, but the very first one we must consider is timing. Can the Lord come back at any time? In other words, is the return of Jesus Christ imminent? Jesus Christ said that it is. Steven Anderson says that it's not.
Now, there's a false teaching out there, the pre-tribulation rapture. And that false teaching says that Jesus Christ can come at any moment, that he could even come tonight. That's a false doctrine, because the Bible's really clear that there are many things that need to come before Jesus Christ returns.
Now, to those of us who believe what Scripture teaches, what Anderson just said sounds like blasphemy. Fundamental Baptists definitely believe in the imminent return of Jesus Christ. It's one of the hallmarks of our doctrine. You cannot contradict the Lord in this matter without getting onto some very dangerous ground, which he does. Let's look at some scriptural facts that we must always keep in mind when studying the end times. The most significant doctrine of eschatology is that Christ can return at any moment. It's what the Bible plainly says. This doctrine is the heart of end times events. Everything revolves around this doctrine. Many of the details of the last days are somewhat obscure, but this is not one of those. There is no question that the Lord can return at any moment. Be ye therefore ready also, for the Son of Man cometh at an hour when ye think not. But of that day and hour knoweth no man, no, not the angels of heaven, but my Father only. In discussing Christ's return, Jesus, Peter, and Paul all use the imagery of a thief coming in the night because everyone understands that terminology. It means that it's unexpected. You're not going to know when it's coming. It's going to be sudden and surprising. It will not be preceded by warnings. If Christ, Peter, and Paul all warn that the Lord's return will catch an unwary world by surprise, that of necessity means that there will be no signs preceding His coming. It's Bible statements like these that have convinced millions of Christians that the tribulation cannot come before the rapture. Otherwise, His return would not be imminent as the Scripture describes. Anderson, though, is very bold in contradicting Scripture and the Lord on this point.
And so, the coming of Christ is over 3.5 years away, friend. You know, you can buy those green bananas because Christ is not coming back in 2017. He's not coming back in 2018, 19, or 20. It's just not going to happen, friend, because the Bible gives us a whole list of things that have to happen first, and they're going to take over 3.5 years to happen. It's that simple.
He's marked himself as a false prophet on this and many other topics. Scripture tells us that we are not looking for signs, but rather we are looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Scripture teaches us that the day of the Lord is at hand, right now, right this very minute. Let your moderation be known unto all men, the Lord is at hand. Be ye also patient, establish your hearts, for the coming of the Lord draweth nigh. Even though Anderson condemns date setters, he has fallen into the same trap, just from the other side of the hole. The date setter tells you when he is coming back. The date canceller tells you when he's not coming back. But they are both defying Jesus Christ, who says that no one knows when he's coming back. The imminent return of Jesus Christ is an insurmountable doctrine for those who want to place the rapture in the middle or at the end of the tribulation. You cannot believe in a post- or mid-tribulation view and believe that Christ could come at any moment. There are so many things that will be set in motion during the tribulation that are described in detail in Scripture that everyone who believes the Bible would know exactly what is going on. As you have already heard, Anderson admits this. But the imminent return of Jesus Christ is not the only reason we reject Anderson's heresies on this issue. Anderson's second great error about the tribulation is not understanding that God still has dealings with Israel. Because Anderson has made Old Testament prophecy concerning Israel of none effect, he cannot understand New Testament prophecy, which is built on top of the old. The tribulation has nothing to do with the church. It has everything to do with the world and with Israel. It is the final week of Daniel's 70 weeks, and that entire prophecy is Jewish in nature. During Daniel's 70th week, God will judge Israel and the lost Gentile world for refusing their only hope of salvation. Why does this period of time not include the church? Because the church is a heavenly body. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who hath blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ. We are blameless in Christ, and we are delivered from future judgment. Who shall also confirm you unto the end, that ye may be blameless in the day of our Lord Jesus Christ? At some point, every saved person called on Jesus Christ and acknowledged Him and received Him as Messiah. That is not true of Israel as a whole or of the Gentile nations of this world. God's wrath has been satisfied for those who are saved and who are a part of His church. The tribulation, on the other hand, is called the time of Jacob's trouble for a reason. Not only will God judge the world during the tribulation, God will allow the satanic forces of this world to come against Israel in judgment. The kings of this earth will make one final attempt to devour Israel, and at least 2/3 of the Jews will be killed during this last great war. And it shall come to pass that in all the land, saith the Lord, two parts therein shall be cut off and die, but the third shall be left therein. And I will bring the third part through the fire, and will refine them as silver is refined, and will try them as gold is tried. Now listen to the results of this judgment that God brings. They shall call on my name, and I will hear them. I will say, it is my people. And they shall say, the Lord is my God. Their refusal to acknowledge their Messiah, Jesus Christ, has brought untold hardships on the Jews. But the Holocaust will be child's play compared to the time of Jacob's trouble. And as for the world at large, this is the time when all the world's proud glory will be brought to nothing. The church is not a part of this. For the last 2,000 years, the world has done what it would with Christians and their churches. But at the start of the tribulation, their suffering will be over and the suffering of the world will begin. The tables are going to be turned at that point. 2 Thessalonians 1:7, and to you who are troubled, rest with us, when the Lord Jesus shall be revealed from heaven with His mighty angels, in flaming fire, taking vengeance on them that know not God and that obey not the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, who shall be punished with everlasting destruction from the presence of the Lord and from the glory of His power, when He shall come to be glorified in His saints and to be admired in all them that believe, because our testimony among you was believed in that day. You see, we can rest knowing that our deliverance is accomplished and that it will be finished at the very time that judgment comes down on this earth. Jude says the same thing. After warning churches about allowing the ungodly into their midst, he says, and Enoch also, the seventh from Adam, prophesied of these, saying, behold, the Lord cometh with 10,000s of His saints to execute judgment upon all and to convince all that are ungodly among them of all their ungodly deeds which they have ungodly committed and of all their hard speeches which ungodly sinners have spoken against Him. According to Jude, the Lord's saints are going to be judging this earth with the Lord, not receiving judgment with the world. We are delivered from wrath. This will be a time when God's people will finally have the upper hand. All the godly who have suffered persecution for believing in Jesus Christ will be under the protection of their Savior and head, the Lord. They will be with Him in judgment against this earth. They will be calling for vengeance against the wicked. As you go through the book of Revelation, we do not see the church again after chapter 3, but we do see the dwellers of this earth and we see Jews, both clearly identified. There is no description of God's people suffering in the book of Revelation unless it is those who come to faith during that time. But we do see the redeemed of God calling out for the Lord to take vengeance on the world. And they cried with a loud voice, saying, how long, O Lord, holy and true, dost Thou not judge and avenge our blood on them that dwell on the earth? Who's dwelling on the earth? the enemies of the Lord. Third, Scripture says that the wrath of God is coming on the children of disobedience. God, in His patience, has been withholding His wrath. But as we look around today, we know that it cannot wait much longer. The entire world is just as the Lord described the days of Noah. This earth is saturated in wickedness. Perversions are normalized. Sin is the order of the day. And for whom is His wrath reserved? God is jealous, and the Lord revengeth. The Lord revengeth and is furious. The Lord will take vengeance on His adversaries, and He reserveth wrath for His enemies. Those of us who have turned in repentance and received the Lord Jesus Christ as our Savior have been delivered from further judgment from God. We regularly face the judgment of men, but at the beginning of the tribulation, it will be God who will be judging the earth. Therefore, we have no part nor lot in this matter. For God hath not appointed us to wrath, but to obtain salvation by our Lord Jesus Christ. That is the verse that convinced me of the pre-tribulational rapture view. Listen to Peter. And spared not the old world, but saved Noah, the eighth person, a preacher of righteousness, bringing in the flood upon the world of the ungodly. God delivered Noah from global judgment. Read on. And turning the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah into ashes, condemned them with an overthrow, making them an ensample unto those that after should live ungodly. And delivered just Lot, vexed with the filthy conversation of the wicked. The Lord knoweth how to deliver the godly out of temptations, and to reserve the unjust unto the day of judgment to be punished. When God's wrath turned against the earth in Noah's day, and against Sodom in Lot's day, God delivered His own. His wrath is coming again, but His children will be delivered. We are waiting for His Son from heaven, whom He raised from the dead, even Jesus, which delivered us from the wrath to come. The fourth point we would make is that Scripture calls for a time on this earth when the Holy Spirit is removed, which opens the door for all of Satan's program to come out into the open. 2 Thessalonians 2:7, "For the mystery of iniquity doth already work, only he who now letteth will let until he be taken out of the way. And then shall that wicked be revealed, whom the Lord shall consume with the spirit of his mouth and shall destroy with the brightness of his coming, even him whose coming is after the working of Satan with all power and signs and lying wonders and with all deceivableness of unrighteousness in them that perish because they receive not the love of the truth that they might be saved. And for this cause God shall send them strong delusion, that they should believe a lie, that they all might be damned who believe not the truth, but had pleasure in unrighteousness." We see a definite transition take place in this passage. This passage tells us that the Holy Spirit is keeping the mystery of iniquity in check, but once He is taken out of the way, Satan will move quickly to complete his program. The Holy Spirit indwells the servants of the Lord, and He is taken out of the way with those He has sealed. We cannot even imagine what this earth will be like when He who letteth is taken out of the way. Anderson glories in the fact that he stands almost alone in what he teaches, which is one of the warning signs of a false teacher.
I mean, let's face it, those who believe in a pre-trib rapture, they all say that the tribulation lasts for 7 years. I mean, we could just start visiting the websites of Baptist churches, and pretty much almost every statement of faith on the website of every Baptist church or every evangelical church would say, you know, there's going to be, you know, the rapture is imminent, followed by a 7-year period of tribulation, blah, 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 right? They all just teach this like just a parrot just repeating this over and over again. Right? 7 years tribulation, right? 7 years tribulation, you know, without thinking about it, because there's nowhere in the Bible that says the tribulation lasts for 7 years.
The Lord did not give insight to only one person, but it is the stock and trade of occultists to act as if they are the only person in the world with the ability to understand the deep things of God. Those who argue for a pre-wrath or mid-trib rapture try to say that the wrath of God is not going to be falling during the entire 7-year period, but they are wrong. When the Lamb of God, slain from the foundation of the world, steps forward in Revelation 5 and starts opening seals, it is a declaration of war against this earth and an end to God's long patience with wicked men. With God's children delivered from this world, His fierce wrath will fall in seemingly endless torrents of misery for those who dwell on earth. Famine, satanic deception, war, earthquakes, massive hailstones, the sea turned to blood, a demonic horde of locusts, sores, the fouling of all drinking water, men scorched with great heat, darkness over the earth, all of which will be capped off by the battle to end all battles, Armageddon. Unless the Lord himself comes to put an end to the misery, there should be no flesh saved. Stephen Anderson and those who follow him teach that the pre-tribulational rapture is a new idea, but that's a lie. It's as old as the New Testament, and it was taught throughout church history. I'm including a link to an article by David Cloud showing that anyone who rightly divides Scripture will arrive at the doctrine of the imminent return of Christ, which is the cornerstone of Bible prophecy. The coming of the Lord is imminent, and therefore it would be wise to listen to Jesus Christ and reject those who contradict him.